皆さんこんにちは、ナイヤです。今日は皆さんと私の日本語の勉強のコツとか、自分の経験の話をしながら深掘りしていきたいと思います。 I know many of you are learning Japanese, and today I really want to focus my tips around efficient methods and ways that you can kind of blend your learning into your everyday lifestyle. So keeping in mind the sense of just being efficient andcareful with time, here are the timestamps for all the sections that I talk about. That way you can go directly to the one that you want. So here they are. So just to give a little bit of an intro to myself, I've been studying Japanese primarily on my own for the last 7 years, and I've learned a lot in that experience. And so here are the best ways to learn Japanese for free, because I did not spend a single pennyto learn Japanese, and so if I didn't spend any money, you don't have to either. So I'm just gonna start off with kind of just getting into the basics. Just wanna talk about hiragana and katakana. It's just very basic. Many of you probably already know these writing systems, but just to give beginners kind of an idea in terms of where to start. I always get that question, and I would say that starting off, it's really confusing where to reallykind of dive into, because there's just so many components. But you have to learn hiragana and katakana, I swear. Like, it sucks because it's pure rote memorization. And I literally just made paper flashcards for them. Like, I literally printed out the words and I put them all together in a box. If I find it, I will put it in the video right now. But that's the best way to really learn and hone in on the basic characters. People usually say you can learn hiragana and katakana in like a couple days. I took longer. I took maybe a month or two just to make sure I know everything. I kept stumbling over the same ones. For anyone who studies hiragana and katakana, like, let me know if you've run into this. There are always like a couple of characters that look so similar, and I'm unable to tell the difference sometimes. And one of those that I kept tripping up on was the katakana for sa and the hiragana for se. Like, I put them right here, but they look so similar. But anyway, in terms of resources for this, you just can print out like a list, or you can check out tofugu.com. I always mention them because they're just the best resource for all things Japanese, and I really learned a lot from their website. So check that out if you want to learn hiragana and katakana. Okay, the second point that I really want to drill in is input and output. Input is really something that we do when we're learning a lot, right? You know, I recommended that you really just get involved with the culture and kind of let that be the driving passion for you to continue to be motivated with your Japanese learning. But when you're doing that, you're learning hiragana, katakana, and you are watching movies, you're listening to music, you're doing all these different things that are just going into your brain, and with anything, you need to use it to actually keep it. My experience, like, I constantly watch like TV shows and things like that, wrote down words I didn't know, continued to really just practice that. But what I also did at the same time that I was doing all that inputting was writing little journal entries. So I used Lang 8. Honestly, this website is pretty underrated, but it's really just so helpful in writing just journal entries in the language that you're learning. And other native speakers of Japanese can just go right in and help you and correct the sentences on the spot. I did it for like a year or two when I was first starting out, and I'll show you one of my journal entries right here. It's gonna be embarrassing or uncomfortable. I'm not gonna say it's not, but that's actually more of the reason why you should do it, because you'll become very acclimated to it at the end of the day. And Lang 8 you can use as an English speaker as well. And I also created a Twitter primarily for learning Japanese. And, you know, Twitter is a big deal in Japan. So many Japanese people use Twitter. And so I felt like it was the perfect platform to just sort of write little posts throughout the day, to tweet throughout the day, practice my casual Japanese. And so I did that for a while too, and I posted my Lang 8 entries on that as well. And so kind of utilizing everything on the internet in terms of a language tool could be an interesting way to output. I think these methods really remove the burden of just like feeling like you have to study all day. That's why I never really felt like I was studying, to be honest. It was just very fun, it was very natural because I was blending those language studying moments into my regular day. So like one thing I recommend a lot is the Japanese app. It has a bunch of flashcards and you can basically look up words in the dictionary of the app. And you can put it into a list and study that list in terms of flashcards every single day. And it uses the spaced repetition system, the best system to do flashcard studying for languages, especially Japanese. And so doing all that is kind of making it easier on yourself. And in that sense, I'll add an additional tip. Besides just adding Japanese to your laptop, which can really facilitate like a better experience in terms of Japanese learning, you can just quickly just type things out. Besides that, one other thing that I did was I followed random people on Instagram who posted in Japanese. So I know this is like kind of, okay, Anadia. but I just used social media to the point that it just all became an advantage for me. And I want that for you too. Don't be a slave to social media. Use it to your advantage. So follow some of your favorite celebrities or some interesting Instagrammers who maybe post like stories or something about their everyday life. And you can really catch up on a lot of words that you don't know. And that's kind of how I stay on top of new Japanese slang or things like that. So I'll give you an example of that. I think utilizing Twitter especially and Instagram, I learned about like the GoTo campaign, which is going on right now in Japan. It's somewhat controversial, but you know, I wouldn't have known that if I wasn't looking for it. And so really just staying on top of those topics can help you in your conversations to better output and better create conversation with your friends. All right, so number three is something I've also mentioned before. And so what I did was often go to a live streaming website where a lot of people speak Japanese, and I basically tried to keep conversation with the person that was live streaming via the comments. And that's really hard because you have to quickly just reply as fast as you can. You have to understand quickly and get your comment out there, or else the conversation won't continue. And that really helped me improve my typing skills, my listening skills, and I really recommend that. I think it's like a very now thing because you might have your favorite celebrity doing an Instagram live or something. I think listening to that really helps you listen to natural Japanese and kind of, even though you're not studying abroad per se, you can get your ears very used to that spoken Japanese. And another thing that I always struggle with is I can't understand people on the phone. Like, even if it's English or Japanese, I just can't. And so by actually forcing yourself to hear people speaking in the language, not in like a video per se, but in a live stream, you can actually hear more of the tendencies people have and how natural like fillers are and things like that. If you watch YouTube videos or movies, people articulate very well, and it's not as natural as it would be in real life. And I saw that in like, I couldn't understand a lot of my friends when they were talking amongst themselves because the Japanese was one, really fast, and two, the kind of words they use and just the speed and everything was just so different. It took me a while to kind of get used to people's unique speaking styles as well. And honestly, like, especially now with Zoom and everything, you know, having to clearly hear someone over like a Zoom call is so difficult. And so kind of taking that up a notch with a different language could be very beneficial. And so this was another point that I wanted to make. Let's say you have a lot of Japanese people in your area. You have some friends and you talk, and that's kind of how you pick up the language. I've met people like this and it's really amazing how natural their Japanese sounds. But one thing just to be wary of is that depending on where in Japan they're from, they could have an accent. So like Kansai ben or Hakata ben or all kinds of different accents are out there. I mean dialects. They might have a different dialect and they may be using that with you. And which is totally fine if you want to learn that dialect. However, we are language learners, so we are going to be picking up every word that we hear, your friend's tendencies or dialect or words from their dialect are going to become a part of your language skill. And just being aware of that is very important. So I've really done this because I have friends from like the Kansai area or like Fukuoka, and their dialects have totally just become a part of me to the point that it's just like a mix of different dialects. And I've had people tell me that it sounded like I was from the countryside, like some random countryside, because my Japanese was so mixed up. I mean, obviously I can control it, but when I don't, I can really see all these different hōgen dialects kind of mixing into my language, which isn't the cleanest. And if you are planning on working in Japan, usually the standard is Hyojingo, which is the basic standard Japanese. And so if you want to be careful, like, you can't use those dialects. I wouldn't say it's advisable to use such dialects in a business setting. So just be careful of how other languages, other dialects might affect. I swear, it's like throwing a pink shirt into the washing machine with all your lights and darks and everything, just throw it all in and you mix it and you get it out and you look at it and everything's pink. That's what happens, basically. So if you want to avoid that, just a disclaimer, you know? All right, so we have reached almost the end of the video. One last final tip that I have is to really, no matter what you do, whether it's writing blog posts, and I've been doing that recently with Note. It's a really popular blog website that Japanese people use to just write about all kinds of topics, and it's very aesthetic and nice. You can do that in HelloTalk too, by the way. Writing posts, I think that helps as well, and people can correct it. Really let go of that embarrassment in terms of, well, my Japanese isn't that good yet, I don't know. Like, just go for it. And another example of that would be to read Japanese books. Even if you don't understand everything and it really feels pointless, sometimes what I did was grab, like, I had a Grimm's Fairy Tales in Japanese. I just had the book. And so I would try and read it. I would read something simple like Hansel and Gretel. And I still don't understand everything, but kind of reading through it, noticing words that you know is really exciting and keeps you motivated to study. I don't see why you need to spend a lot of money on textbooks or other things. And the books that I just mentioned, yeah, you do have to spend money on them, but what I often did was go to used book sales, and they usually have a section for Japanese books, at least in my area they did. And I went to a bunch of them and kind of picked out little books or magazines that I liked. So those books usually are pretty cheap. One thing I've picked up recently is if you go on Amazon, there are actually a lot of Japanese books that you can get for free just through the Amazon Kindle books. You can kind of find a couple free ones, load them into your Amazon Kindle reader on your phone. And so I did that with some children's books. Once you have a basic understanding of the language, it's a great way to practice and learn at the level that you're at, essentially, and kind of work up. I talked about a lot today, but that's mainly because I want these videos to be as useful as possible, and so I wanted to talk about different instances, different tips that I have, so that way you can think about how you've learned Japanese up until now and how you can improve your experience and take it to the next level. So thank you so much for watching. If this video helped you out, leave a big thumbs up or leave a comment if you have any questions. If you would like to share your Japanese learning experiences, I would love to hear them. If you have any tips or advice, we can all help each other out. 見てくれてありがとうございます。じゃあねー!